And we're back for another episode of Unsung. You can catch us on the web at www.unsung.us or on iTunes or SoundCloud if you search for WFYL and Unsung. We have two parts of the show. First part is the FCC Airwaves part that's Saturdays at 1:30, and that goes for half hour. And then we have a podcast where we go after the show, and that's always available online for people. This week, we're going to do something a little different. I'm going to try and do this quarterly, and hopefully I don't have to do this because this isn't a good thing. It's one of those things where you're talking about a problem, and I hope the problem goes away, but I don't think it will. I'm talking with, the mother of a missing person from the area. The person is Toni Lee Sharpless. I'm sure at some point someone's heard the name. She's been missing for 7 years now. And I reached out to her mother because I wanted to do something. There's nothing I could do in a search and rescue capacity because there's just nowhere to start. But I wanted to do something. And I think the time has passed where a little awareness. I really believe in all the cases I've worked, whether they're resolved in a day or a year or 5 years, that somebody saw something, that somebody remembers something who just doesn't think it's important. And I don't think they're hiding it because they're mean-spirited, evil, or being deceptive. I think they don't think it's important. And when Toni Lee went missing, it was, and correct me anywhere I'm wrong, August the 23rd, it was the 23rd, 2009, she went missing off of, in the area of Bowborn Road in Gladwin, between that and River Road. She was driving a 2002 Grand Prix black four-door. And this would have been very late at night. She came in there from a club earlier, went to a sports celebrity's house for a party, left after the party, had an altercation, got an argument with a friend, and left a little angry, and hasn't been seen since then. I've got her mother here, Donna Sharpless, Knobel.
Knobel.
She just told me how to say it, and I messed it up in 10 seconds. And I wrote it down here with a big K so I'd remember. Thank you for taking the time to come and be on the show.
You're welcome.
And I have one of the guys on my team who I told you a story out there because we talked for a while before this, who always brings up this case to me. And he... he brought it up again, and I told him that we would do it whether, you know, I'd reach out to you, and if not, he had to speak and say the facts, and he didn't want to, and is very glad that you did it. I'm very glad that you did it because I think that I can relay passionless facts and statistics, but you're actually going through this and living it. Is there anything, as somebody's going through this, and we kind of talked about this a little bit, but now that you've been indoctrinated into this horrible club of people that have loved ones that are missing, is there anything that that you would tell somebody who it's just happening to give them advice?
Oh, definitely have hope. Seek out all the information from everybody. And sometimes there's people that give you clues and you have to ignore them, but there's other little ones that you could pick up on here or there. Give them to authorities and hope they run with it. Or sometimes you have to do this yourself.
And that happens quite often, that you're doing a lot of the fact-finding and work yourself. And I see that in a lot of cases, and I am a firm believer that the information to resolve these things are usually, if things were done right at the onset, they're usually in that beginning data. I remember that when this case came about, not that it was at the beginning, but it was near the beginning of when social media was so pervasive. And part of the thing was I watched, this was actually the case that made me stop looking at the comments that people put on things, because I just feel that the comments are just, they're just visceral and mean-spirit, speculative dribble for the most part. And if there is a good comment in there, it's so buried, you'll never get to it.
Right. That's so true. Because I was told, don't read them. You'll be really hurt and upset.
Yep.
So I just stopped.
And that's what everybody should do, because you're going to want to respond to and fix every broken person out there that says an incorrect fact about your loved one. And I see that happen a lot. It's just ignore them. Ignore them. They're just trolling around. They're trying to make it into something they can get attention about. Is there anything, knowing what you know now, at the beginning that you would do differently?
Not that I can think of. Because that was, it's been over 7 years. I traced everything that I possibly could. Thoughts go through your head. The what ifs. What if I would have done this? What if I would have searched here? I don't know that I would have, I don't know where I would go from there.
Well, Toni Lee was, she was a hardworking single mom. She was a nurse. And you know, that's a profession that's one of my favorite professions. I like nurses. I like teachers. I think they're highly underrated. And she had that night, she had been battling demons off and on, and she had just won her last battle and won it in a big way. And that night she was like, many, many nurses. She was without sleep for far too long, because, like, if you're not in emergency services or shift work that's 12-hour shifts or something like that, you think that a hard day is 17 hours or whatever, you know, from bed to bed, you know, but you can be in shift work and be mandated and that, and you can work 24 hours straight, you know, and that combined with medicine, a little alcohol, is a bad formula. And that's part of what precipitated this whole incident, which ultimately ended in what is still to this day a complete mystery.
Right.
Her daughter, how old is her daughter now?
She will be 20 years old in May.
20 years old.
She was 12 when Toni went missing.
And she's, yeah, she's went from a child to an adult.
Very quickly.
Yeah.
Very quickly.
And that's got to be difficult. And she was technically the last person that she communicated with.
Yes.
If we take everything at face value.
Yes.
Via text message.
Via text message.
And I've always, you know, and the point of this is that people hear the story, feel the story, because somebody might know something. Share the story with somebody. Somebody in that area might know something. If anybody has ever driven on River Road in Gladwood, if you've got a car down there in the middle of the night, it stands out. If you've ever driven on River Road in Gladwood, even when under the best conditions, if that's a new road to you, it can be a little treacherous. It's a very scenic road, but most scenic roads are a little deadly, you know,
right.
That's what makes them scenic. You and your husband have gone there multiple places. You've looked at places. You've, had help from Eileen Law and other people. Is there anything that you feel has worked or bore any fruit? Is there any, what do you feel overall social media? Do you feel that it's just a wash, or good or bad?
I'm going to say a wash, only because you try to keep it alive, but people get numb. So when you back off, they assume either she's been found or she's passed. So you got to keep it alive. But if you do it too often, people get numb to that and they just don't listen anymore.
And people have really short attention spans now, and they want to go on to the next story. And, you know, I think of I've watched missing people bump other missing people. And it's not because that person is not important or doesn't cease to exist, but we have short attention spans now. And it's tough. It's tough to see, to keep it in the public's eye and keep it fresh without making it bringing too much unwanted attention to it. It's a tough mix. You want the right amount of attention. And I've been in talks with the governor's office about it. This almost needs to be a social service after the initial part, so they can be kept alive. Somebody can keep researching this case in the interim while the police are dealing with murders and other stuff that's active. And because it gets dumped on a detective who's got 80 million things happening in between, and he can't give it the attention, but he needs to own that, and it needs to have another place to go. And then when somebody sorts through the 8 million callers and people that email in, and they go back to him and say, I've got this letter from this person that I think bears some, you know, it meets some criteria for authenticity. And there was a letter, was the last thing with Toni Lee.
Correct.
That came in August of 2012, 2011.
No, it was January.
January. And that letter seemed to have some authenticity to it because it had
pertinent information.
Pertinent information. Let's just leave it at that. That the average person wouldn't know. And it was beyond what somebody that even read all of the stories would know. But that was discounted for some reason.
Right.
It was, and I'm sure they have a reason for that. But it was discounted as a hoax. And there, I saw there were two hoaxes on the case. There were two times that they felt that things that came in were a hoax. And I don't know what the other one was, but they felt it leads that came in. And that happens a lot because people want the attention.
Right.
It's absolutely bizarre. And there's nothing that I think that can prepare a family member for what you're going through.
Not at all. Not at all. You hear of these things happening to other people until it happens to you, it'll blindside you.
When the letter came in, what was your feeling on the letter?
I had a lot of hope. I just, like I said, there was a lot of pertinent information in there, and I thought these are the best clues we've had so far, and nothing became of that.
Did the letter actually name anyone?
It did. It referenced a couple people as police officers, but nothing became of that either, from what I understand.
Okay. And people are getting, with social media, people are getting, they have easier access to just giving their opinion. And nobody ever starts with, in my opinion, or I'm just speculating here. Everybody uses the tone that I actually saw it, I actually was there, you know, and that's part of what makes it difficult. And in the times that we've worked with families at all different stages of missing person incidents, what we found over the years, and this took 20 years before I started to put it together, it takes 6 or 7 years before the family actually comes and they come to peace with it. And that's 6 or 7 years after.
Correct.
After. You haven't even been allowed to get to the
That point.
That point. You're in this horrible holding pattern.